Hey guys, it's me Ida, welcome back to my channel. So today this video is all about how to tell if you are protein sensitive and what the signs are of protein sensitive hair. Okay, so when you're using products that have protein in them, you notice that your hair feels really dry, stiff, hard, rough, straw-like, brittle. Sometimes it's really hard to tell right away if you're protein sensitive or you just have protein overload from using too much protein in your regimen. So what you want to do is you want to do this test where you're using protein-free products for a while and then you introduced a product with protein in it and then see how your hair reacts. Because someone that has protein sensitive hair is going to experience protein overload a lot faster than someone that's not protein sensitive. So once you start incorporating products that have protein in them, try to see how long you can go with using those products with protein in them. And if your hair reacts really negatively towards it, when you're getting dry hair, stiff hair, brittle hair, really quickly, then you know you have protein sensitive hair. Because we all need protein in our hair because our hair is made up mostly of protein. However, people with protein sensitive hair just need less proteins than someone that doesn't have protein sensitive hair. So this test can be a little tricky because it all depends on what type of proteins you're actually using and how much proteins are in the product and how often you're using the protein. So it's gonna be a lot of trial and error, and basically everyone's hair is different and every product is different. So protein overload is basically experiencing dry, stiff, and brittle hair after using a product that has protein in it or high amounts of protein in it. And as a result, that means there's too much protein in your hair and not enough moisture. Anybody can experience protein overload. You don't have to be protein sensitive. Sometimes, you know, you just have way too much protein in your regimen and you're using proteins every single day. And eventually you might have way too much protein in your regimen and you have to kind of, you know, cut back on the protein. So someone that is protein sensitive will just experience protein overload a lot faster than someone that is not, but they can both experience protein overload. So for me, because I have protein sensitive hair, I can use proteins maybe like once or twice in my regimen back to back, and then I start experiencing really hard and dry hair. So just like how you can experience protein overload, you can definitely experience moisture overload as well. And so that's just basically having way too much moisture in your regimen and not enough protein. So you definitely have to have a nice protein moisture balance in your regimen so that you can have healthy hair and prevent hair breakage. For me, I can tell when my hair is over conditioned and I have moisture overload. My hair is just kind of lifeless, it's just really limp, my curls are not popping like they usually are, and just like feels like really mushy and just, it just doesn't feel right. And that's when I know I have to add in protein into my regimen. Okay, so if you have protein overload, how do you fix and repair protein overload? So number one, stop using protein in your regimen. Just stop that immediately. Look at all the ingredients in your labels, make sure that there's no protein in there because you don't want to have hair breakage from really dry and stiff hair. And then you may have to wait a few weeks. You have to wash your hair, remove that protective layer that protein does have on your hair, and then just focus on moisture, and then eventually you are going to have a proper protein moisture balance. And then you can just basically go from there, slowly incorporate the proteins back into your regimen to see how much you need in your regimen. Once you get the hang of it, once you know how your hair is and what your hair likes, what it doesn't like, you're gonna be able to tell exactly how often you're gonna add protein in your hair and how much moisture is gonna be in your hair. Usually for me, what I would recommend is always focus on moisture because, you know, when you have curly hair, usually it's going to need a lot more moisture than protein. And then kind of add in the protein as needed. Some people that are protein sensitive, they just don't require additional proteins from products as often because their hair already has enough of its own protein. If you have healthy hair or low porosity hair or coarse textured hair, your hair may not require additional proteins in your hair because you do have enough of your own natural proteins and you just basically require less of it. Then that means you may have protein sensitive hair. If your hair is damaged or color treated, relaxed, or if you have high porosity hair or fine to medium textured hair, your hair will probably require additional proteins more often and you may not be protein sensitive. The protein will help strengthen the thin strands of fine to medium textured hair to help prevent hair breakage and to prevent overconditioned hair. Also, the protein will help close the holes and gaps in the cuticles of damaged hair, and the protein will form a layer on high porosity hair to help retain the moisture. Healthy hair doesn't really have any holes and gaps in their hair because it's healthy, so they don't actually need that protein to fill in any holes and gaps. And someone that has coarse textured hair may not require additional proteins because they have thicker hair strands and they don't really need the help of protein to strengthen their hair strand because it's already strong, unlike someone that has fine textured hair or medium textured hair. And someone with low porosity hair may not require additional proteins because their cuticles are closed and they don't really need the help of additional proteins to help form a layer to help retain the moisture, because low porosity hair is really good at retaining the moisture because their cuticles are closed, unlike high porosity hair with open cuticles. So of course this can get really complicated because someone can have, you know, characteristics of both. Someone can have low porosity hair and fine textured hair, and usually that person will require proteins a bit more often because they do have fine textured hair, so they have to get that strength, but they have to be very careful with what kind of proteins they're using because they don't want to have product buildup form on their low porosity hair. So usually they can get away with using smaller size proteins. Okay, so once you have determined that you are protein sensitive, now you have to see how often you're gonna add proteins into your regimen and what type of proteins you're going to add into your regimen. So I've noticed that my hair is able to tolerate smaller size proteins, and I'm gonna put up a list of like the main ones that I can use in my hair for a bit longer before experiencing protein overload. But what I've noticed is that people that have protein sensitive hair basically typically like using smaller size proteins because they're not going to sit on top of your hair and make your hair feel hard. They're going to penetrate into your hair just enough to give it that strength that you need to have that proper protein moisture balance. So for me, basically what I do is I actually use protein-free products throughout my whole entire regimen when it comes to shampoos, conditioners, deep conditioners, gels, all of that. Everything is protein-free. And every second month, I can tell my hair is kind of getting moisture overload. That's when I'm gonna add in a protein treatment. And basically my protein treatments are light protein treatments, and I notice that it's a lot easier for me to control the amount of protein that goes into my regimen by actually having protein-free products and then just kind of adding in a protein treatment whenever my hair needs it. If you're not sure if your product has protein in it, usually the word protein will actually be in the ingredient. However, there are some proteins that actually don't have the word protein. They'll have like keratin or collagen. They'll have like the word hydrolyzed before it, just meaning that, you know, you broke up that protein into smaller pieces so that your hair is able to easily absorb that protein into your hair cuticles. So I'm gonna put up a list of common proteins that are actually found in hair care products. Here are some other proteins that are actually found in your homemade ingredients. These are not small enough to actually penetrate into your hair like those other ones in commercial protein products, but they will form a layer on top of your hair that will strengthen your hair as well. So you are gonna feel the effects of a protein treatment when you're using them. Coconut oil is not actually a protein, but it does help retain the protein in your hair, and it does prevent the loss of protein in your hair. Okay, so I hope this video was helpful, and I know it could be really tricky and confusing. I do have other videos all about protein, have a lot of details on them, but I also made videos on my favorite products that are protein-free. So definitely all the links are gonna be in the description box below. Again, as always, thank you guys so much for watching. If you guys have any questions, of course, leave them in the comments below and I will answer them. Have yourselves a wonderful day, and I'll see you guys next time. Bye.